without accepting any asking price. We have seen any asking price and then some in the recent years. The more you say, it's like central banks, like the Fed when they have to stem inflation, right? If you say, I'm ready to do whatever it takes, of course, then something happens. If you say, we are going to print as much money as is needed to solve a problem, then inflation comes in. It's basic economic issues. So our idea was to try and not accept any possible price, whatever it takes to get open access, by a fair and competitive process to figure out how much we were ready to pay. And I'm going to discuss a lot about these details. Another key element is that in exchange for being remunerated for the publishing of open access articles, the publisher would reduce the subscription packages, the buckets, the bundles, to every single library, so the money could be freed in order to go into the paying of article processing charges. One key detail that we had to go through is, fine, if we do it globally, so we take all the journals which are there in the field, we discuss with them, we flip them to open access. How much shall I pay, which is my bill? And again, we thought about it globally. If we are paying for a service, which is the service of peer reviewing a given number of articles, you use a service for as much as you. You pay for a service as much as you use this service. Now in content, purchasing subscriptions, you pay for FTEs, you pay for clicks, you pay for downloads, you pay for your loyalty discounts, you pay for any kind of strange alchemy, and you don't exactly know why you pay what you pay. That's the content world. If we move into a service world, in a service world, you pay as you go. The idea was then to take the entire production in high energy physics, to see how much every country was contributing to these productions, and apportion the total in this way. And I tell you, taking a paper with 3,000 authors and counting all of them to figure out in which country they work is a bit painful. So that was the idea. Germany would pay 9% of the total, Japan 7, Italy 7, the UK 7, the US 25, and that the idea is simple. Publishers reduce subscriptions everywhere, money is freed, money is put together in this proportion, we pay publishers. That's a very simple idea. And then we get into the details of the implementation from 2011 to today. And you know what is in the details. We started in 2011 to put real things together. And again, we started from the very beginning with the international view to it. We formed a technical working group trying to figure out how you calculate how much a title is worth in a package with person coming from four continents. We formed a steering committee which was taking week by week all the decisions together with CERN on how to implement this. And again, we had a person coming from the States, from Asia, from China, from and Japan, from all over the world again. And we set out with a task which is apparently not simple, which was to try and arbitrate between the supply of services for peer review and the demand for services for peer review, and arbitrate between supply and demand in a global setting, because we wanted a service to cover the entire field. What we are left to do is, again, to reuse what we knew how to do. Let's say, OK, let's try to copy and paste it once more and see whether it works. What at CERN we do, we have spent $9 billion to build the LHC. Some of this money was ours, some of this money was from our member states, some of this money was coming from 700 universities all over the world. We have a process to do large-scale public procurement. You do call for tenders, you have to fix the best value for money, we know how to buy the LHC, we know how to build tunnels and dig tunnels, which are 27 kilometers around. So the process that we had was a very technical procurement process, like it happens also in normal state governments. You ask companies to bid for what they want to offer you. You rank companies according to their price, according to their quality. So the conversation which ensued with publishers was to say, OK, we are ready to pay open access to you, but that's a service. And we want some quality for our service. A component of the quality was the impact factor of the journals, because once you have to do a public procurement process, you have to use numbers which are uncontroversial as a third party. It was only one part. The other part was, oh, you know, if we get a lot of quality, you can charge more. For us, quality is Creative Commons licenses. Surprise, surprise, we got CC BY-SA, an offer from all publishers. Another thing that representing quality for us was, what do you give us? Surprise, surprise, we got full text XMLs, nicely formatted and mineable, out from publishers. So as a discussion of articulating what you are ready to pay, which is a service which has some factors of quality, we already obtained far more value for public money than the value present in a content business. The other factor that we had in our procurement was price. The higher the quality, the more price you can charge. But if the quality is low, the price has to be down. And in addition, we needed a commitment from publishers that would stick and reduce the subscriptions for all the participating libraries and all libraries in the world. It gets technical very shortly. We asked to all publishers, how much do you want? And we got an answer back. These are fictitious numbers. Then what we did was to rank all journals and publishers according to their price and their quality. If a journal had a high price, and sorry, if a journal had a low price and a high quality, it would come at the top of the list. If a journal had a low price and a high quality as well, and so on and so forth. That's bizarre. If you are in a library and you are buying subscriptions, as we were discussing before, you are operating in a market which is not a market of substitute. You cannot buy the cheaper subscriptions instead of another one. That's content which is not interchangeable. If you are operating in a system where a service has to be evaluated for how good the service is, you have factors like price and volume and quality which can be put together. And this has been quite an innovation since the participants in this market were large subscription publishers, which were the same participants in the market of subscriptions when he said nothing is changeable. What we did was to just have this big list of all publishers, how many articles they were expected to publish, and according to how many articles they were expecting to publish, the top journal, the one on the top, this fictitious number, let's pretend that they wanted $2,000 per paper, they had 1,300 papers, they would get a contract of 2.6 million. They would have a second one, and so on and so forth, with a catch. The catch is that we had a fixed amount of money to spend, which means that at a certain moment, you would arrive at a line, and publishers below that line would not get a contract. They would have to continue doing their ordinary subscription business. And now that's extremely interesting, because by the act of saying beforehand that you have a fixed amount of money, which is capped, and there is nothing more than that, and according to how good is the quality, you can get away with a given price, we have created a market which has pushed the price to the down. The result from the tender, I'll give you the slides later on, but they are online. This is the very complicated results of the tender. One publisher decided not to participate after 1 year. The result of the tender was on an average article processing charge of 1,000, that's more readable. The average article processing charge which came out from this process was shy of $1,600, which is a very low value if you take into account which are the participants in the market, which had article processing charges around twice as much for the same titles in hybrid before we started discussing. So at the end, you see a very diverse set of journals, European, Chinese, African, and global. I don't think I discussed with you the technical and financial detail of this thing. This is boring, but there is a fact. The fact is that if you want to take something which is, at the end, a $21 million operation, which has thousands of participants and real legally enforceable contracts, you have to go through that. We were very fortunate in that CERN lent us the infrastructure, legal and commercial, which is used to build these big machines. So we could do something like SOAP 3. I move past the details, and I move into the results. The results is that in 2014 now, 1st of January, we have started operation. How are we putting this together? We are putting this together through a partnership. Our partnership at the moment, we have 28 partners, which are the entities which are paying into this common fund out of which we do Scope 3. Those represent 35 countries. We have over 2,000 libraries which are participating through those partners at the moment. This is a list of the countries which are at this moment paying into Scope 3 and they are participating. And we are having quite advanced conversation with 7 more countries for their participation. So we will get soon, hopefully, to 42 countries which are participating into this process. In the US, what we are doing is to have this process run at a library-by-library level. In most other countries, you have some central agency or some central consortium or a few entities which can speak with a single voice for the entire set of libraries in the countries. Unfortunately, this is not the case in the US, where we have had some amazing, fantastic advocates which have worked one by one now with over 200 libraries which have joined our partnership. Every library in the US which is subscribing to these journals, I want to be clear, is getting money off from the publishers. 100 of those, which are less than the total number of libraries, are contributing back to Scope 3. The others have so far chosen to free ride in the scheme. This is the list of libraries which are in our partnership from the state. Texas Tech is coming in, I think, yesterday or tomorrow. That's why it's in parentheses. This is not an exhaustive list of libraries of Texas. I let you make the derive a conclusion from the difference. And how have we put this together? We have put this together thanks to a team of volunteers, because at the end, the only Scope 3 staff was me, a third of me, and one other person, plus a little bit of a lawyer and a purchasing officer at CERN, which was lent to the process. We are operating a $21 million operation, basically with no staff. These are the volunteers in one of our many meetings at CERN. And what have these volunteers done? These volunteers have helped thousands of libraries in 42 countries understand what we were doing. Sometimes helping libraries understand something is just helping them grasp the idea. In other cases, it has been to build some extremely precarious library alliances in a country to get to support Scope 3. In other cases, helping libraries through an idea can be a slightly harder work. Or in some places, especially like in the US, helping libraries participate can be even a more complex herding process. The good thing is that we are in operation. CERN is financially backing the contracts as of January 1st, 2014. As the money is continuing coming in, we are paying publishers. These are real transactions happening. And these are some numbers. We have published 1,600 articles already in those journals, which are open access. So we are on target to get to around 4,000 by the end of the year. There are scientists from up to 82 countries which have benefited from Scope 3, which means that if you take all the articles which have been published, you see where people come from. They come from 82 countries. There are over 2,500 libraries that we are aware of which have been reimbursed money from publishers because these journals have gone open access. Out of those, only 2,200 are participating to date. Our APCs are getting actually even lower than we thought, and I want to discuss a few details because those might be interesting. So these are as articles are published, the publishers within 24 hours of publication, they are on the publisher website and they are open there. In addition, we ask them to be shipped in a repository that we operate at marginal cost on our infrastructure at CERN, so that this is a staging platform where we can see what comes in. So all articles are there, and you can download the XML or the PDF if you want. All articles are CC BY. The metadata is CC0. The XMLs are there. We have OAI PMH feeds, which are open for Scope 3 libraries. If they want, for instance, every time an article from a scientist in your university appears, then you can get it through OAI PMH straight into your institutional repository. We are working on opening an API. And we have agreements with publishers that as ORCID IDs get known for all the authors, they will push them to us so we can again populate, for instance, profiles automatically. These are all added value services which are possible once the content is free. Don't need to pitch this to you. We have 82 countries where authors are benefiting from this process. You remember I mentioned that we had 42 countries which are participating in Scope 3. This is clearly a disconnect. But think a moment of the disconnect, because today what happens is that those who can afford buying subscriptions, they are effectively subsidizing the peer review service for the entire world. In the system that we have, countries are paying for their peer review services. And in addition, there were the fine prints that I didn't discuss earlier on. is that every country is actually, who can, is contributing slightly more than their slice, so that the peer review services can be paid for those who can't afford to pay. If you run something like PLOS, or BMC, or any open access journal which charges article processing charges, you understand that at a certain moment there is a long tail of country who can't afford the $1,500 to come in. So you have waivers. How do you build a waiver in this system? Here, the author does not pay to the publisher to publish. The author doesn't even know what is happening. So the waiver has been built in the sense that every country which is contributing in this common fund, which we run at CERN, is putting a little bit more, and this little bit more cumulatively is covering the article processing charges for all those authors, and there are 40 more countries which are not yet contributing in. Something which is coming out, and that's the first time we show this, is how much is this really costing. Now, there are two or three things I wanted to mention. One thing I wanted to mention is that, and I do not have nice pictures of predators here, once you start a scheme to say to a publisher, I give you a blank check to publish everything you want in this journal and I'm going to pay for it, you can't do that. I mean, we have financial, we are an international organization like the UN and CERN, we are above national laws, but we have financial rules. Our financial rules say no blank checks, of course. How do you do a no blank check rule? No blank check rule was done in such a way that when we tendered with publishers, we told them, okay, we pay up to a given amount of articles, which is how much you published in 2011, and everything which comes on top of that, we don't pay. And then there are interesting phenomena, because if there is a journal which becomes very popular and grows a lot, basically all those articles come in without us paying them. The counter incentive is that there is no incentive to publish a lot just for making money, because A, you don't make money, B, your impact factor goes down, and in 3 years' time, we are going to redo the entire process, and your impact factor is going to be counted for. So this is the result, one number at a time. This is what we are paying on average in Scope 3 now. In dollars, we are paying $1,450, because many articles are going in journals where, on average, we are going to reach this total of 2011 volumes very soon. We are starting to be competitive with a plus one-ish kind of price. The second thing I want to show here, that's one of our interns has done that, this is how much is the APC market today as a function of the impact factor for a series of options. I have in warm color, yellow and red, titles which are open access today, and I have in cold colors, hybrids. This big area here are the hybrid prices of Elsevier. You see that there is no connection in the hybrid prices of Elsevier between how much you pay and how much is the impact factor. You have titles which have an impact factor of 0 or 12, which all have hybrid at 3,000, 4,000, 5,000. The pinkish dots are Scope 3 journals. Scope 3 journals offer for the same impact factor consistently better value than other APCs which are around. You see, all these pink things are low in this big cloud of points. What does this mean? This means that by having had a tendering process where quality and price were taken into account together, and there was a total maximum amount of money that we were ready to spend, you create a force which is leveling down. The most interesting point is these two arrows here. These are two journals which were selling hybrids before Scope 3, and this is where those two journals have gone in the, these are two Elsevier journals, after Scope 3. So their offer to enter Scope 3 was a sensibly more, a sensibly lower value than it was earlier on. So that's some first analysis. I repeat, that's the first time we put these slides together because we have never started the operation before. It's just a few months we are doing that. I've already spoken for very long. I would just like to make some quick comments. I think I don't want to explain too much about how we have the governance of Scope 3. We have a very complex governance which takes into account countries and states and regions, and is very inclusive and very diverse. I would like to make some comments on questions that will very often come when we describe, use it to describe this initiative, all the objections we heard before when we were told this was impossible, it will never happen, and questions which are coming now. One question which often comes in is, fine, you started in 2006, it's 2014, it took you forever, for sure, it can't work somewhere else. It did take very long. One answer we usually have is that in some endeavors, which are global, things often are the prototype of themselves. It takes a long time to build something which has never been done before. Another question which comes is whether this is actually really sustainable. The answer we can give is that we started with 5 countries in 2006. We have now 42 countries which are participating. It is not a mystery, if you compare this list with this list, that we have not yet been able to establish a partnership in Russia, in Brazil, in India, and in some smaller countries, but we're working very hard with that. And for the time being, CERN is acting as a guarantee of last resort for the contracts. We have contracts which last 3 years with publishers. We are committed to pay for the 3 years of the contract, and we see that slowly the partnership is growing, and we are on the path to sustainability. A question which very often comes in is, yeah, fine, this only works for high energy physics, and now we shouldn't bother paying attention. You'll have to do very complicated things. Can it be replicated? Can you take it and print another one? Here I'm going into a very speculative series of answers. If you go on our website and you look at the list of the partners which are actually paying into Scope 3 and they're getting the reduction from the publishers, you will only find 2 to 3 high energy physics institutes. Everything else which is on that list are universities whose libraries cater to the entire spectrum of knowledge. You find a national funding agency which finance everything in their country, national library, library consortia. The partners that we have put together for the very first time with the international consensus, thanks to CERN convening power, are actually not directly related to high energy physics, with the exception of CERN itself. If you look, and that's on the demand side, if you look on the supply side, most of you know all the names which are on this slide. Since I am the only high energy physicist in the room, it means that the publishers that are participating are actually broadband publishers. So what we have actually done for the very first time is to put together a way to arbitrate a demand for open access and a supply for journals in a different way. The partners stay. So how do you replicate it? Very recently, we are, of course, starting to get quite some questions from funding agencies, from fields, neighboring or not, from publishers, who want to understand more. The analogy that we give is, of course, a simple one, because it is actually simple. If you just separated the three components of what we have done, that's the last thing I would like to leave you with. On the one hand, what Scope 3 has done is to say, oh, I know what I want to convert, I know which is my target. Everything which is on archive, which is about high energy physics, is a very clear target. How do I find the money to do that? I take the money which is in the subscriptions today, plus top-up funds as they might happen in some systems. And how do I do it? I do it by using these public procurement rules that CERN has. If you split these three things, if you separate them and you look at them from a little bit of distance, you see that it's not so unreproducible or complex. There are many ways to define a target or what you want to convert. For a funding agency, it's easy, it's everything I finance. For a project, it's everything I publish. For a university, it's everything which comes out of my department where I'm leading author. For a discipline, it's everything which goes in my 6 leading journals. You see, even if you don't have archive, even if you don't have high energy physics, you can define a desired target or what you want to convert to open access. Where do I find the money? The fact that 15 to 20% of the scientific publication today is published as open access, it means that there is money in the system for open access. And we all know that there is money in the system for licensing. The fact that at least once it has been possible to unlock money out of the licensing deals and reuse this money to pay for open access services, it means that it's not impossible. On the last pillar is, how do I do that? And again, according to what you want to convert and how you want to convert, you can look at different ways. You can look at ways to hashing existing licensing agreements, as many are doing, in order to get more value and services. There can be agency-driven, library-driven, or even publisher-driven agreements, which can try to get enough backing to flip entire journals. What I guess I'm trying to get to is that, yes, it has taken from 2005, when people started talking about that, to now 9 years to get to the point. But we have demonstrated that it could be done, because after all, it was the prototype of itself. That's the entire brain dump of what I wanted to discuss, and I want to leave just a few minutes for questions at the end. So, thank you.